For a decade, China's $300 billion battery empire has had a stranglehold on the world's energy future. Their weapon? Lithium. But what if I told you that with only $56 million and 2 years of R&D, a tiny American startup just built a battery that could break that stranglehold and already connected it to the U.S. grid? A battery that requires zero lithium, zero cobalt, zero rare earth metals of any kind. A battery that can't catch fire, that you can run completely dead without damaging it, and can run in extreme sub-zero temperatures, and that's made from some of the most abundant materials on Earth. Literally, iron, carbon, and salt. As an engineer, this is the type of story I love. So when Peak Energy announced that they had quietly built and deployed the world's largest battery of its kind, I knew we had to dig in and separate the hype from the reality. Is this the breakthrough that can finally give America energy independence from China? Let's figure this out together. I'm Ricky, and this is 2-Bit Da Vinci. This video is brought to you by Jackery. So what exactly is Peak Energy, a tiny startup out of Colorado? And what did they actually do a few weeks ago? Well, they're a team of expert ex-engineers from companies like Tesla and NRG who founded a company in 2023, raised $65 million in funding, and went into R&D stealth mode for 2 years. Then, out of nowhere, they went live with America's largest sodium ion battery, the first grid-scale battery system using a chemistry called sodium iron phosphate, pyrophosphate, but let's just call it NFPP. It's a battery energy storage system now actively supporting the grid as part of a microgrid project with Flathead Electric Cooperative in Montana. Now, on the surface, a new grid battery is interesting, but not revolutionary. But this is where we have to look under the hood, because the engineering and chemistry here are amazing in their simplicity and potential. So here's what makes this battery game-changing. First, and for me, this is the big one, it's inherently safe. We've all seen videos of lithium-ion batteries going into thermal runaway, catching fire, and even exploding. It's a violent chain reaction fire that's incredibly difficult to put out. The chemistry in Peak's battery simply does not support that reaction. The molecular structure of the cathode material is exceptionally stable. You can try to get it to catch fire, and it just won't. No fires, no explosions for a massive utility scale battery sitting on a community. That's not a feature. That's going to quickly become a necessity. Second, it's built to last in a way that completely changes the logistics of battery deployment. You can transport these batteries at a 0% state of charge. Now that might sound like a small detail, but it's a massive deal. Lithium ion batteries have to be shipped at a partial charge, typically around 30%, and are classified as class 9 hazardous materials. That means expensive, complicated, and risky transportation. Peak's batteries can be shipped completely inert, dead flat, dramatically simplifying and de-risking the entire process. And once they're on site, they require zero maintenance, no moving parts, no liquids to top off. You just set it and forget it. Third is the supply chain freedom. It's completely free of lithium, cobalt, nickel, and manganese. It's free from all conflict minerals and rare earth elements around the world. We're going to dedicate an entire section on this later in the video because it's the geopolitical ace in the hole. It's why I think this tiny startup might just be onto something and can finally end China's monopoly. So then that brings us to what it's made of. Literally dirt and salt. The core materials are sodium, which we can get from soda ash, iron and phosphorus, which we can get from phosphate rock, and carbon for the anode. These are some of the most common, cheapest, and most widely distributed materials on the planet. We're not talking about a fragile global supply chain. We're talking about materials you can find in almost every country on Earth. But the engineering breakthroughs go even deeper. One of the biggest costs for any lithium-ion battery farm is the HVAC system. You need massive air conditioners and complex liquid cooling loops to keep the batteries from overheating. It's called the thermal management system, and it constantly consumes energy just to keep the batteries in a safe and stable space. Peak's technology has an elegant solution: passive cooling. Because the battery chemistry generates so much less heat, they don't need all the complex hardware. The modules are designed to dissipate heat naturally to the surrounding air. Getting rid of the active cooling systems is a massive engineering win. It slashes the upfront capital cost, and more importantly, it slashes the operating cost by getting rid of the parasitic energy drain from pumps and fans and other balance of system components by a staggering 90%.
I'm here at RE Plus in Las Vegas at the Jackery booth, and I want to show you something. Jackery makes amazing batteries that are all over the place to power all the stuff you want wherever you are. But this year they have a really key focus on essential home backup solutions like this, the HomePower 3000. This is a 3 kilowatt hour battery with 3,600 watts of power output. The HomePower 3,600 Plus starts at 3.6 kilowatt hours of storage. With those add-on battery modules, you can go all the way up to 21 kilowatt hours for all that deep extra storage to really power your house. Combine it with a Solar Saga 500 solar panel, and you can keep them topped off every morning for extended outages. And then finally, there's the HomePower 5,000 Plus, which starts at 5 kilowatt hours of storage. And thanks to the add-on modules, you can go all the way up to 40 kilowatt hours of power. Now, these batteries can power your house in the event of an outage, but you can also take them camping in an RV or anywhere else that you need them. They're not fixed to your house. And this smart transfer switch from Jackery means that you can have critical loads moved over to this panel. And when the power goes out, the grid will be shut off and you'll power just the essential loads all from your battery pack. This is the most sophisticated and advanced way to have battery backup power. It means you just plug into your outlets and you just use all the stuff that you normally do entirely backed up from this system. So check out the amazing new lineup of Jackery Home Power Essential Solutions and be prepared for anything today.
Peak claims their system is already 20% cheaper to operate than the best grid scale lithium systems. And that's a number that's only gonna get better at scale. Then there's the temperature resiliency. A lithium-ion battery is a bit of a diva. It likes the same 70-degree weather we do. If it gets too hot, it degrades. If it gets too cold, its performance plummets, and charging it below freezing can cause permanent damage. Peak sodium-ion battery operates happily from a bone-chilling negative 40 degrees Celsius all the way up to a blistering 60. For a grid asset that needs to work reliably through a polar vortex or a summer heat wave, that is a huge advantage. And finally, there's the way it cycles. We've all been trained to protect our phone batteries by keeping them between 20 and 80% state of charge. That's because draining a lithium-ion battery to 0% or charging it to 100% too often puts stress on the materials and kills its lifespan. Peak's battery has a fully usable depth of discharge. You can cycle it from 100% down to 0% and back up again, day after day, with minimal degradation. So you get to use every drop of energy that you paid for. This also ties into its discharge curve. A battery's voltage is like its blood pressure. In a lithium-ion battery, the voltage stays almost completely flat from about 80% of state of charge all the way down to about 20. It's like a fuel gauge that reads full forever and then suddenly drops to empty. This makes it incredibly hard for the battery management system, the BMS, to accurately know the battery's true state of charge. A tiny measurement error can lead to a dangerous overcharge or let the battery drain too low, causing damage. Sodium ion has a much more sloped voltage curve. Its voltage drops predictably as it discharges, from about 4 volts down to 2. This is a huge advantage for the BMS. It can read the voltage and know exactly how much energy is left, making it far simpler to manage the battery safety and extend its life. Now, there's a trade-off. For electronics that need a constant voltage, which most things do, you need power electronics like a DC-DC converter to smooth out that voltage swing. But for a grid application where sophisticated power controls are already part of the system, this challenge is pretty easily managed. When you add all this up, you get to that grand promise. You get a battery that is cheap to build, cheaper to run, safer, more durable, and made from common materials. The U.S. Department of Energy has set a goal of getting grid-scale energy storage systems below $20 per kilowatt hour. That's the magic number that makes a 100% renewable grid not just a dream, but an economic certainty. This is a technology that could potentially get us there. Okay, so when I saw all these claims, my engineering brain immediately went off and started firing off questions. It all sounds incredible, but how is it all possible? It sounds like that impossible win-win-win situation that just doesn't exist. But first, a quick clarification for credibility's sake. Is Peak Energy's battery the world's first sodium ion battery ever? No, that title actually goes to a massive 100 megawatt hour system that just went live in Shenzhen, China in 2024. But, and this is a critical distinction, that battery and others like it use different chemistries. Peak's battery is the world's largest using this specific, incredibly safe sodium iron pyrophosphate chemistry, and it's the first grid-scale battery of its kind deployed in the U.S., and it's a huge milestone. So now let's get to the questions. Question number one, why doesn't it catch fire? The answer lies in the fundamental chemistry of the cathode, the sodium iron pyrophosphate. The bonds between the phosphorus and the oxygen atoms in the pyrophosphate group is incredibly strong. This creates a highly stable, three-dimensional crystal structure. Even at high temperatures, this structure is extremely reluctant to break down and release oxygen, which is the key ingredient needed to start and sustain a fire in a battery. NMC, nickel, manganese, cobalt, lithium ion cathodes, on the other hand, will decompose and release oxygen at much lower temperatures, kicking off that thermal runaway chain reaction. Question two, so how can it be passively cooled? This follows directly from the first answer. Thermal runaway in a lithium battery is an exothermic reaction. It releases a tremendous amount of energy as heat. The stable FPP chemistry is simply less reactive. During normal charging and discharging, it generates significantly less waste heat due to the internal resistance and chemical properties. Less heat generated means you don't need a complex, energy-hungry liquid cooling system to cool it. A well-engineered module design that allows for natural air convection, which is just the heat transfer to the surrounding air, is enough, which is a masterpiece of efficient design. Question number three, why can you drain it to zero? Again, it comes back to that stable crystal structure. In many lithium ion chemistries, when you remove all lithium ions from the cathode to fully discharge it, the structure can become unstable and even physically collapse, causing irreversible damage. The FPP crystal structure is robust enough that it can handle having all the sodium ions shuttled out of it and over to the anode. It maintains its structural integrity, ready for the ions to come back on the next charge cycle. This is what allows for the 100% depth of discharge without rapid degradation. Question number four, why is it so good in the cold? This actually has more to do with the electrolyte, the liquid medium that the sodium ions travel through. One of the biggest problems for lithium ion in the cold is that the electrolyte becomes sluggish, and the lithium ions struggle to move, crushing performance. What's worse is trying to charge a lithium ion battery below freezing can cause lithium to play onto the anode as solid metal, forming dangerous dendrites that can cause a short circuit. The electrolytes developed for sodium ion batteries have a different chemical composition that maintains good ionic conductivity even at very low temperatures, allowing the battery to perform reliably when the lithium ion batteries would have already given up. Now we get to what I think is actually the most compelling part of this story. It's not just about the science, which is cool. It's actually about the ingredients themselves. It's about building the future on a foundation that's sustainable and a supply chain that we can actually support. First, Peak Energy's all-American recipe. To build their battery, you need four key things. You need aluminum for the current collectors. You need sodium carbonate, also known as soda ash, for the sodium. You need iron, and you need phosphorus. For the anode, you just need hard carbon. So where do we get them? The U.S. has the world's ninth largest aluminum production capacity. For iron and phosphorus, the U.S. has massive domestic reserves. And soda ash? Wyoming is home to the Green River Basin, which contains the largest soda ash deposit in the world. It's been called the Saudi Arabia of soda ash. We can source virtually 100% of the raw materials for the battery right here at home. Now, in contrast, let's look at the lithium ion's tangled global web. The recipe for a standard NMC battery is a bit more exotic. You need lithium, you need cobalt, you need nickel, and you need manganese, and you need highly purified graphite for the anode. So where do we get these from? Well, the raw lithium might come from Australia or Chile. The cobalt comes overwhelmingly from the Democratic Republic of Congo. Nickel from Indonesia. But the critical step is the processing. China doesn't have the biggest reserves of these minerals, but they have built a near total monopoly on refining them. Today, China refines roughly 60 to 70% of the world's lithium, 70 to 80% of its graphite, and a staggering 90% of the manganese. Now, I don't have to tell you what this means. You can see it for yourself. One map shows a secure domestic resilient supply chain built on common materials. The other shows a fragile, complex global web where nearly all roads lead through a single geopolitical country, in this case, China. And this is the difference between energy independence and energy dependence. The telltale sign that you're onto something is when the giants start coming after you. And make no mistake, the race for sodium ion batteries is heating up. Peak Energy has a unique approach, but they're not alone. In the U.S., you have other innovative startups like Natron Energy, which is focused on a different type of sodium ion chemistry for data centers. But the real 800-pound gorillas are, of course, the Chinese giants, CATL and BYD. They see the writing on the wall as well. They too know that a future totally reliant on lithium is a future with a ceiling on growth and a floor on cost. They're pouring billions into their own sodium ion research. CATL, the world's number one battery maker, has already announced its own sodium ion battery, which is set for mass production by the end of 2025. We actually got a first-hand look at CATL's tech when we went to their tech day last year. It was absolutely amazing what they're doing. Truly is mind-blowing. Check it out for more details in the links below. But here is the critical difference, and it brings us right back to the supply chain. While these big players are pushing the market forward, their chemistries are mostly based on Prussian blue analogs, or PBAs. The world's largest sodium battery in China, I mentioned earlier, its cathode is a sodium copper iron manganese layered oxide. Do you see the common thread? It's manganese. Even in their sodium ion batteries, they're still dependent on the manganese supply chain, where China controls 90% of the refining. So it's not really an issue for CATL or for the other Chinese giants. But it's different if you're trying to make batteries in other countries. From all my research, Peak Energy is one of the only companies developing a battery with the potential to be truly and completely independent of these supply chain choke points. Their FPP chemistry is their strategic advantage. If you know of any other companies working on similar chemistries that are completely self-reliant of those elements we mentioned, let me know in the comments below. I'd love to reach out and learn more about them. All right, so it's time for a dose of engineering reality. This battery is not a magic bullet that will replace everything overnight. There are trade-offs. The biggest, you probably guessed it, is energy density. Cell for cell, sodium ion has a lower gravimetric and volumetric energy density than high-end nickel cobalt manganese lithium ion batteries. The sodium ion is just physically larger and heavier than lithium ion, so you can't pack as much energy into the same space or mass. But, and this is a huge counterpoint, its energy density is already comparable to the workhorse of the EV world, the LFP, or the lithium iron phosphate battery. These are the cheaper cells that you normally find in lower range cars. So the Tesla LFP battery pack will have less range than their NMC, or their more exotic battery packs that offer higher levels of energy density. There's also one other thing to think about, which is the pack level advantage. We talked previously about how Peak's battery doesn't need a complex thermal management system. Well, those systems are heavy and bulky and they don't add to the energy density, right? So if you need cooling ribbons or water flow for cooling, that's all mass that doesn't equate to energy. This would reduce that. So those sorts of advantages could close the gap on the best and highest energy density lithium ion batteries. And so while you might have been thinking that the sodium ion battery is only going to be for stationary storage, and I do think that will be its main use case, using it in cars is not off the table. That's why CATL is betting on sodium ion for automobiles. They're betting big on the good enough revolution. Does everyone need a $100,000 EV with 600 miles of range? No, the vast majority of people commute less than 40 miles a day. A super safe, ultra long life and radically cheaper commuter car with 250 miles or 200 miles of range would be a massive win for EV adoption. That's a market the sodium ion is poised to capture. So where does this leave us? We have to be realistic about Peak Energy's position. They have the tech and they have the patents. They have a working grid-connected product that proves their science works at scale. But they are still a tiny little company at the pilot stage. They don't have the manufacturing muscle or prowess of a company like CATL. This isn't the story of a single battery deployment that changed the world overnight. This is the story of the first major shot being fired in the American battery race. It's a proof of concept for an entirely new blueprint for our energy future, one that is more resilient, more affordable, and most importantly, more independent. Peak Energy has shown that it is possible to challenge the empire. The question now is whether they and companies like them can scale up fast enough and take this technology to market in a meaningful way. Like many of the things that we cover, that always is what it comes down to. Even EV startups like Rivian and Lucid are still struggling to completely reach full-scale production. It's a tough thing. Making things and manufacturing them at scale, one of the hardest challenges there are. And many other companies have failed at this stage. Companies like Northvolt, which was a really promising battery company that filed bankruptcy earlier in 2025. But what do you think? Do you think Peak Energy has the potential to break through? And could this be that disruptive battery that makes energy storage ubiquitous? Sound off in the comments below. And until next week, check out this video that we did on CATL sodium ion battery next. I'm Ricky with Da Vinci. Thank you so much for watching.